and nutritional mental issues. So these people who are world-renowned actors, celebrities, I mean all of them, Elton John, Michael Phelps, one time gold medalist who won most of the medals in Olympics, the doctor, actor, comedians, and a princess, most renowned world famous writer, Winston Churchill, Abraham Lincoln. They all suffered from a mental disease and they all thrived in their life. So where are we? What are the tips for a healthy life? So we have to have a balance in what we do and we have to love what we do. We have to love what you do. Learn good coping skills, regular exercises, eat fresh food, have a hobby and more hobbies. You have to, most importantly, forgive, forget, and foresee. So all these three qualities will give you some sort of relief. Of course, a good sleep. And they say in WHO website, the 2022 Mental Health Day, that people with good health will connect and they will function and they will cope and also they will thrive in life. So I found these facts on mental disorders, which are alarming, and why that we should care for mental disorders. Global disease burden is 10% of substance use, mental and neurological disorders. 1 in 5 children and adolescents have a mental disorder. Isn't it alarming? It's 20%. 264 million of world population is depressed and that causes disability. Half of disorders of this type start before age of 14. We should care. 800,000 people die annually due to suicide. And that's the second leading cause of death between age between 15 and 29. That's the second most leading cause. People with mental disorders die. That is not just mental disorders, but severe mental disorders. They die at least 2 decades before their years. 1 in 9 people in conflict and threatened situations will suffer from moderate to severe mental disorders. So WHO speaks about the crisis situations in the world, wars, COVID-19, and displacements. There are 84 million in the world right now displaced due to conflicts. So that's a common and known risk factor for mental illness or mental problem. Mental health workers, if we take developing countries, for 100,000 population, there are only 2 mental health workers. In developed countries, there are 70 mental health workers. Less than half of the countries of 139 countries that we are talking about, or the countries registered in the world with mental health policies. And they report that they are aligned, the mental health policies are aligned with human rights. At some point of life, the mentally ill people, the people who are suffering from mental illnesses will suffer from severe violation of human rights and discrimination plus stigmatization. So caring for mental health is very much important. If you take global economy, $1 trillion of US dollars is lost globally annually due to depression and anxiety disorders, which are most common among mental disorders, depression and anxiety. So close to 1 billion people right now are suffering with mental disorders. And due to COVID-19, we added 25% more of population with anxiety and depression. So if you take the monetary wise, the financial wise, if you spend $1, you will get $5. If you spend on anxiety and depression, if we are increasing the treatment centers, the facilities, so we get fivefold of investment, the profit back to the world. So we should invest on anxiety and depression treatment facilities. Economically, schizophrenia is the most devastating mental disorder. But if you take depression and anxiety, that is the most common what we find in the population worldwide. On average, psychiatric hospital, they absorb 66% of the health budget, the mental health budget. But all countries in the world, mostly they spend only 2% from their annual health budget to mental health. That is, that should be eye-opening and eye-catching thing that we have to think about as policymakers if we have our positions as policymakers. Loss of employment is a known risk factor for suicide and mental health problems in the world. And currently that is a global scenario. During COVID-19, after systems collapsed and treatments gaps are widened. So that is an alarming fact. Because 2 years in Sri Lanka, if I talk about Sri Lanka, we could not go to communities and we could not talk to people face to face. And we were avoiding the social interactions. But mostly some part of the world and some of our doctors, they tried to go to telepsychiatry or telemedicine methods that we can see people with video and all that. But poor country like Sri Lanka, most of the people could not afford to have digital devices to access their mental care. So one alarming fact is that what I told you earlier, that 25% was added to the 1 billion population who are already suffering from mental illnesses. So that's the fact that I want to highlight here and talk to you about. So why we should care for mental illness. We just passed September 10th, where we commemorated or we celebrated World Suicide Prevention Day. The theme of Suicide Prevention Day was through action, we can give them some sort of relief. So we have to give them light through action. So 800,000 people or population, 800,000 annually die due to committing suicide. So that's also another alarming fact that we have to care for mental health. But most of the time, as a clinician, a person worked for mental health for 15 years in Sri Lanka, I have not seen policymakers are advancing towards mental health facilities or create a sort of environment suitable and conducive for to treat mental health, mentally ill people. So we have to force and enforce our policymakers to make good decisions. If you have some questions, I can answer. So now the screen is yours.
Thank you, Dr. Sita, for a wonderful presentation. Can you have any questions or comments from the participants?
I think, can I say something?
Yes, please.
Hi.
Thank you for a wonderful presentation. I think this is one of the major concern which is being rising and throughout South Asian countries. We see even in the Western world also, but specifically in South Asian countries, because we are not very much aware. Plus, the government itself is not spending much money. They don't think that the mental health is something which is to be taken care of. If I tell you about Pakistan, so we have very limited number of psychiatrists. So the psychiatrist ratio to patient is very low. So especially we were, that's I think the reason, major reason that we need to think about sensitizing and training general practitioners to tackle this issue, the rising burden of mental health, because it's increasing day by day because of various reasons. COVID was one of the reasons, as you mentioned and you've been saying. So the policymakers needs to be sensitized by us. But what they say is that there is no task force. So we need to produce the huge number of task force. That's what we are trying to, you know, if you see all over the world, the psychiatrist ratio itself is very down. Huh? So that, I think it was excellent presentation, what you said. Very related to current scenario. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Davinder.
Thank you, Dr. Davinder. Do any of the other participants have any comments or questions? If I may see a few points regarding Dr. Asita's presentation, I would like to thank you for enlightening us with very few important facts about mental illness, especially about the global disease burden and economic burden, and how there's a gap between developed and underdeveloped countries in the accessibility of mental health care, and also how mental health has affected individuals and community as a whole. I think we had a very fruitful presentation from Dr. Asita. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Can we move on to the next presentation? So I'd like to introduce our next speaker. So we have Dr. Davinder from Pakistan. He is professor and head of Department of Family Medicine from ICRA University. I hope I'm pronouncing it right.
Yeah.
And Dr. will be talking about mental health issues among healthcare workers.
Yeah. Davinder, thank you so much. Yeah. So just let me. Share the screen. So I can't share the screen. Sona?
I have your presentation. I'll try to share my screen.
A second, okay. Dr. Tabana, I'll make you the host. I'll make you the co-host.
Oh, if she's sharing, that's fine.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, Sona, then you can share the presentation.
But you will have to move the slides, bus. Whenever I'm asking, that's the issue.
Please give me a few moments. Yeah. Just need to download your presentation.
Dr. Davinder, you are the co-host also. So if you want, you can share the presentation yourself. So that's totally up to you.
Can you see?
Yes.
Okay. So thank you, Wonka, and especially for inviting me for this day, as I think this is one of the very important area where we are concerned about. So Asita has been sharing about the general population. I will talk about something which is very relevant to us. So I'll be talking about mental health issues in physicians, especially healthcare workers. So I'll be more concentrating on physician. So we know that mental health is state of complete physical, mental, and social well-being, and not only the absence of disease or infirmity, which is defined by WHO. So there is a term called burnout, right? So which is long-term stress reaction marked by emotional exhaustion, depersonalization, and a lack of sense of personal accomplishment. So what happened is that a lot of physician or healthcare workers, which includes the nurses, paramedics, and physician, surgeon, all of us, are very frequently encountered with burnout that may lead to depression, anxiety, stress, and other mental health disorders. So like you can see that day to day, COVID is one of the examples, but if we recognize that we are daily seeing patients, we have, so if I talk about our field, the primary healthcare physicians, we have a major role because we have been dealing with multiple issues which are complex issue at one time. So we, I think, carry the major burden. That's why there is a higher chance that we may also go into suffer from any mental health disorders. So what is the prevalence or the estimate of the problems? Depression, one of the most common mental health issue among physicians worldwide due to high intensity training and work overload, which is there because you know that medical profession itself is a unique profession which will give you huge satisfaction, but on the other hand, it demands a huge amount of work. Plus, there is sincerity and there are huge challenges associated with this profession. So there was a recent systematic review which showed that in a meta-analysis, which indicated that the prevalence of depression among physicians worldwide was around 28.8% higher than the rest of the general population. So we are the one who are treating. And if we will be suffering, so who's going to look after the overall population or the poor people who don't understand the word of depression also? Similarly, suicide rate among male physician is 1.4 times higher than the general population. Female physician are at an even greater risk with a suicide rate of 2.27 times greater than the general female population. So this is an article which says about level of stress, anxiety, and depression among nurses working at Peshawar Medical College, Khyber Medical University Journal, which showed that depression was there in 78%. So 31% among them were severely or extremely depressed, anxiety in 78%, again 40%, and stress in 54%. So huge number. Similarly, there was another study which was conducted in Indian Journal of Psychiatry. If you see, it says around 30% of participants were found to have depression and 16.7% of participants reported suicidal ideations. And about 2/3 of the sample experienced moderate level of stress, another 13% had high level. More than 90% of the participants reported some level of burnout. So we need to find out when does that burnout or the workload has started. So need to, or as a healthcare provider, we need to identify that critical point where we are at the edge of developing various mental health issues. So this was the same article says that this activity related resulted in lower indulgence in recreational activities, experiencing verbal or physical abuse in the hand of the factors which were physical or abused by patient caregiver, feeling that seniors do not show empathy towards patient and senior do not show empathy towards them. These were the reasons which these patient people, the physician, felt they were the reason for causing or letting them go into depression. So there is another study which is also related to, if you can see, mental health awareness illness survey find depression increasing among nurses. So if you can see, it says that 30% of nurses said that they are experiencing feeling of depression. In the latest survey, this increased to nearly 40% of all nurses. Causes are again the same. So mental health, which may lead to sadness, anxiety, and depression. So this is another physician thing. So this is National Physician Burnout and Depression Report 2018. If you can see, the specialty wise, which are the most one feeling or suffering from burnout. So if you can see, I've highlighted the family medicine. You can see 51%, which is quite high number. So emergency medicine has a 60% rate because they are working in an environment where there is huge number of patients with influx, with critical conditions. So obviously it is understandable that they may have, similarly, if you can see critical care, ops, gynae, infectious disease, and we are also 51%. That is a huge number in comparison to if you see public health, dermatology, pathology. So this is a huge number and we need to see what can be done to improve this. So what is the cause of stress in the medical field? So it's the workload or the overload, high expectation, which may be from ourselves. The physicians are usually high achievers and they have high ambitions from their profession as profession to grow. Similarly, they have high expectations from the healthcare organization where they are working, the hospitals or, you know, the healthcare setup. They have high pressure from that side. Lack of work-life balance. There is no absolutely very little work-life balance, insufficient compensation or reimbursement. So this may be one of the reasons which may lead them to take over burden, or they tend to work for longer hours as compared to normal timings. Then at times it's been seen that there are organizations which may ask you to see patients. So they are also being asked to do a lot of administrative tasks. So they have to do multiple tasks at a time, which may increase their stress level, and because they have to meet certain deadlines. Then there are unfavorable organization cultures. As I have discussed previously, there is a lot of patients feel depressed or go into stress because of inappropriate or unprofessional behaviors from patients and their caregivers. That is one, because this is maybe related as there are poor or no safety culture available in the organization. Then there is lack of physical or psychological safety and perceived job security. All these are the factors which may lead to stress or overburden in terms of whether it is a physician, surgeon, nurses, or their healthcare allies. All of them tend to get stress or high level of stress or burnout, which may ultimately lead to depression. So you see that there is a very, you know, there is a whole overlap between stress and anxiety. So there is a recognized threat. It may be identifiable trigger present. Now, so what is the consequences or impact of going, or the physician or the healthcare provider, they go into depression or anxiety or stress or any mental health disorders? So there is a potential for decreased quality of care and poor outcome, which is understandable. If they are not feeling well themselves, mentally not stable, they may not be able to work to the best of care. Then there are increased chances of medical error, which may threat patient safety. Similarly, decreased patient satisfaction is one of the ultimate impact which may occur. Increased physician and staff turnover. So a lot of physicians, because of the workload, they tend to leave that place and keep on switching jobs. Then there is an effect on patient care and safety. Patient medication adherence may be one of the issue. Physician recommended evidence-based screening and health counseling reduce when physicians have poor personal health. So they themselves, when they are not feeling well or not good in their health, they may not be advising or, you know, taking care of their patient to a extent that which is asked or which is expected. Reduce workplace productivity and efficiency. Ultimately, the overall efficiency of that organization goes down, and then cost of replacing a physician, that may be 1 million or something. So all these are the factors. So ultimately, the one major task which we are aiming to do is the improve patient care. But in the process of improve patient care, somehow we get lost, because when there is a poor work-life balance, the physician or the healthcare provider themselves get into that trap and not able to take care of themselves, and they are highly neglected of their self-care, which is very, very important. So if you see, this is a chart that's the same National Physician Burnout and Depression report, if you can see. So they said, does your depression affect patient care? So this is the survey people, what you are saying. 40% said that my depression does not affect my interaction with patients.
only 40%. If you see down the line, so I'm easily separated with patient, less engaged with patients, not active listening and responding, less friendly with patients, less motivated to be careful while taking patient notes, history taking, filling out the electronic health record. I express my frustration in front of patient, make errors I may not ordinarily make, make errors that could harm patients. So if you can see, only 40% are those who say that it's not affected, while rest of the 60%, if you can see, somehow one way or the other is going to affect the patient care quality, and there is a threat to patient safety, which is a great impact, which may create a lot of disturbance in terms of healthcare, and then way that the ultimate goal is not achieved. Okay, so this is, does your depression affect your dealing with colleagues? Less engaged with staff, actively listening and responding, more easily staff appear, express my frustration in front of staff, appear less friendly with staff, my depression does not affect my behavior in workplace, only 22%. While see, they arrive late, they are making errors, they should not make, take longer lunches, make errors that could harm staff and peers. So 22% are saying that their depression or their behavior does not affect the healthcare environment, while rest of them are saying that it does affect one way or the other. That is ultimately making them more fragile, and that may be the concept of team building that may get hampered. So this is very important. If you can see the question, which was, why have you not sought help for burnout or depression? Can you read this? I can deal with this without help from a professional. This is the most common reason that we do, because we ourselves are thinking that we are the healthcare providers. We are providing medicine to each and everyone. We can treat ourselves. That is not sufficient, because we don't know. We may be biased toward ourselves, and we may not be seeing the exact picture or the clear picture of ourselves, and self-treatment may itself may harm, or there may be a denial phase, which may be the reason why we are not willing to go for consultation. Don't want to risk disclosure to medics. One time there was a student of mine who got into health issues, so actually went into depression. So when he was trying to consult the hospital where he was working, he was advised that, oh, do not disclose this depression thing into your work environment, because once they get to know, they will start blaming you and they'll directly kick you out of the job. So this is one of the concern which people have. That's why they are not opening up about their mental health issues, especially when you're working as a healthcare provider, there is a more chance. Concern about it being on my insurance record, and concern about my colleagues finding out. So they're not, they still, even though we think that it is not something taboo, but still inside or in our concept or in our mind, we still think that this is one of the taboo. And if people say that we are on antidepressant or something, this will create a negative image. Oh, you are so weak, doctor. You don't know yourself. But taking meds, something like, so people may start bullying you, concerned that medical health professionals or others. So you can see these are most wider to seek help, and that may worsen the condition, and there may be a chance that people, healthcare provider, are getting more and more mental health issues. So again, self-care, doctors are miserable at this. As doctor visits for themselves, self-prescribed drugs, will not see a doctor. So I will treat myself. Perceived stigma around seeking help or support. A lot of time when you say that doctor, you were on leave. So once a patient said, do you also get sick? So I said, I'm also a human being like you. So if you get sick, you perception.
Priority. and this theme pertinent with the current era. To introduce my country, a beautiful small country that is landlocked in Eastern Himalayas, sandwiched between the two giant countries, China in the north and India in the south, and has a population of just over 0.6 million. And as a gift from a golden throne, the universal healthcare are all free. That means there's no privatizations of any clinics. To talk about mental health care in Bhutan, it is integrated in the primary healthcare system to provide essential mental health care to patients. Mental health care is delivered in a four-tiered system with National Referral Hospital at the apex, two regional referral hospitals. One Eastern Regional Hospital, hospitals, and the basic health. Next. Primary healthcare physicians and the community health worker, we call it health assistants, are responsible for managing patients in their settings. Patient admissions are both voluntary and involuntary. So as mentioned, mental health is at infancy in our country too, with only one mental health inpatient ward in National Referral Hospital and only three psychiatrists nationwide. Mental health is a major public health issue in Bhutan. It's all because of attitudes towards mental illness are influenced by various traditional beliefs like the black magic, evil spirits, witchcraft, curse, or a karma of previous life. And they resort to alternative healing practice, especially religious and faith healing. This contributes to stigmatization and the discrimination of people with a mental disorder. So to improve mental health awareness and literacy among public and healthcare worker is very important. Mental health in Bhutan remains hidden largely because of belief, as I mentioned, and then it results in widespread stigma and discrimination. Neglect of care of people with mental disorder due to lack of understanding and a poor management by healthcare provider and people. Even for a healthcare provider, understanding of management of a mental health of a patient is also not known even at provider level. Thanks. The topic I was given was deliberate self-harm and the prevention of suicide. So I will present a case on a deliberate self-harm I recently encountered. So to talk about deliberate self-harm and suicide, suicide is a top six leading cause of death in Bhutan. An average number of suicide was 8 a month. That is every 90 hours, we are losing one patient to suicide. Suicide and mental health issues in every society and can affect anyone. And then it can affect all walks of life. But the recent studies have shown that young adults are affected more than the older populations. Next. This is a case, a 26-year-old female presented to emergency department with a history of deliberate ingestion of 18 tablets of paracetamol, brought to emergency room by sister after 2 hours of ingestion. And that act, her act was in isolation room when no one was at home. She had no regret of act and was feeling low, hopeless, and wanted to end her life. Retrospectively looking at the history, she had depressive symptoms that she never consulted a psychiatrist. She had mild epigastric pain and a nausea at the presentation. Next, doctor. In past medical and psychiatric clinics, she didn't have a significant past medical history and never been to a psychiatric unit. In a social history, she studied till grade 10 and discontinued to post family support. She was raped at the age of 16 when she was retained and by one of her relatives, but she did not share that incident to any of her family member. This incident still disturbs and often feels so hopeless and doesn't see future. But she had a similar history of deliberate self-harm, like cutting her forearm during her high school days. Next. The management that we, management to that patient in emergency room, immediate care with administration of activity charcoal, supportive care, and patient was admitted to psychiatric unit for further management. Now, promoting mental health and well-being is not a single man show. It is a multi-stakeholder approach with, since it has a multifactorial reason that led people to come inside. So it is said that no single approach or organization will prevent suicide. So there should be involvement of government at the highest level, non-governmental organizations, local government, and then even like religious bodies, police personnel, teachers. They can also play a vital role in prevention of suicide. So mental problems, family problems, and then financial problems are the common reasons why you commit suicide. And then to prevent suicide, comes with some form of warnings, verbal message, or shows signs of mental distress. So it is very important as a healthcare worker to identify the warning signs before patient commits suicide. The patient who commits suicide or completed suicide will have warning signs in a form of a verbal message or a signs of a mental distress. So in Bhutan, to talk about suicide prevention, so we have a national suicide prevention program under Ministry of Health and has launched a comprehensive suicide prevention action plan 2015 to 2018. And we have adolescent-friendly health services in every hospital to cater services to adolescents who has all sorts of problem who comes to a hospital. And then in that, mainly focuses on the mental well-being of adolescents. And in school counseling services, where school counselors are taught to identify the students who are at risk of committing suicide. So in a nutshell, a very small, short presentation, promoting mental health and well-being is an approach where this whole of a government, a whole of a society approach is needed. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Wangdi, for a wonderful presentation. Do we have any comments or questions from the participants?
Do you have any method to educate and organize programs in Bhutan with teachers? But the counseling teachers are in the schools. In Sri Lanka, we have counseling teachers.
Yes. Now, with the recent, I think it's not that old, but now every school has counseling teachers. So they counsel the patient, students who are at risk, and then mostly patient, students who are into substance abuse, and then who are financially backward, and then who shows some signs of mental distress, they seek advice, and then they do cross-referral to a primary care physician to seek medical advice.
Thank you, Dr. Mangu.
Any more comments or questions from participants? If I may add a few points from Dr. Wangdi's presentation. So mental health has always been an underrated issue in Bhutan, I think personally. We have a lot of stigma in our community, and we have patients who are very reluctant to seek help because of this stigma. So I think being brought up in Asian community, the way our family dynamics work, so usually we are not able to tell even our close family members how about any stressful life events. We are not able to seek professional help. So in Bhutan, I think we are still very, very lacking in promoting mental health. So now we have quite a lot of programs in the Ministry of Health that are very active in preventing deliberate self-harm and suicide. So do you have any more comments, questions from the participants? Can we close the session for today? Zainab, do you have any comments?
No, I don't have any questions, but I just have, I would like to end the session on a thank you note. A very, very thank you to Dr. Asita, Dr. Wangdi, and Dr. Tabinda for such informative talks. I think all of the presentations are very, very relevant to in terms of mental health and in terms of primary care practice. So, so thank you so much for joining. And it was a much needed webinar, which webinar and a very important day that we thought that, because mental health issues are always underlying and they'd never, as Dr. Tabinda had also mentioned, that even 49% of even the doctors think that they can deal with it themselves, you know, let alone general population or general people. So these were the important pointers that we wanted to point it out, and by Dr. Asita and Dr. Wangdi also pointed out important details regarding self-harm and the importance of why mental health is so important, and what are the parameters and why is it so important and what matters regarding mental health. So that's about it. I think thank you so much for joining today. And my apologies for the initial delay, because I think there was some issue with the link. So there was some problem at my understanding. So that's why we had a little problem in the initial part. And then I thought that it went off well. So thank you so much, everyone.
Thank you, Linda. Thank you so much. I'd like to thank all our speakers, Dr. Asita, Dr. Tabinda, and Dr. Wangdi. I think we had a very successful academic session for the World Mental Health Day today. So I'd like to thank all of our speakers and all of our participants. I hope you have a wonderful week ahead. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. Good night, all.
Thank you. Good night.
Bye.